Brothers and sisters in Christ, one of the areas in life that, if you know me kind of well, you might know that I am that one of the areas where I know almost nothing, where I am totally incompetent, is gardening. You can especially talk to my wife, Katie. I mean, I know that, okay, plants need soil, right, and water, and light to grow, but that's about it. Anything that I've tried to plant just somehow never seems to live. I mean, part of the reason is, you know, I never really did much gardening growing up. My parents did a little bit. And while Katie knows a lot more than I do, we've moved around so much in recent years that it's been really hard to make anything of it. But there is something of gardening that I can understand. And if you're like me, you can understand too. Is that when certain plants, like types of bushes or like the vines that Jesus talks about in our Gospels, if you leave those wild simply to grow in an area, it's really easy for them to get tangled up around each other. Or it's very easy for other obstacles or even other creatures to choke them or to block the light so that they can't reach their true potential. Someone who is an experienced gardener, among other things, knows that you need to prune or cut the branches to make them grow so that they can spread out to the light, not spend their energy getting tangled with each other. But like I said, grow and ultimately bear much fruit. And what is one of Jesus' more famous sayings today? He compares himself to a vine. And he tells us that his Father is the gardener. But when Jesus says this, he's also talking about us. Let's take a minute again and hear the first verses of what Jesus said. When speaking with his disciples, he said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes it so that it will be even more fruitful. You, that is my disciples, you are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me." Now, first off, when Jesus is speaking here, at the very beginning, he makes the statement that he is the true vine. The true vine. These words come right after what our verse of the day chorus was based off of, where Jesus said that he is the truth, the life, the way. No one comes to the Father except through him. The passage where Jesus promises to send his Spirit to remind us of all the things that he has spoken so that we can believe in him and grow in him. A reason that Jesus has to say that he is the true vine is because there are many false vines. You can think today of the many false vines that exist. Among religion itself, there are many false beliefs that we need to stay clean from, so to speak. As Lutherans, something we love emphasizing is that we are saved by faith alone, apart from works. But if you talk to a lot of people about religion, works come up pretty fast. Works are the way that so many other religions talk of how to get to God, if not all, right? Jesus says that he is the true vine. There are many false philosophies in our world. For example, there's the philosophy of determinism. You might not know the word necessarily, but there's many people who believe that everything that's ever happened or ever is going to happen is just the result of cause and effect. Everything is just a measurable, predetermined path. And that leads to some things that I would not call fruitful. In today's digital age, it's hard not to be exposed to the marketing world, let's call it. The philosophy that if you just had this product, or if you just enrolled in this service, you're going to have everything that you need in life. But you have to pay more money, and the years come around, and now there's a new product. Of course, I could go on, couldn't I? And what's amazing for us to think about, though, is Jesus spoke these words 2,000 years ago. And throughout the many different philosophies, different worldviews, different vines, so to speak, that there have been, the one that has stood and has not changed is the gospel of Jesus Christ, is the message that he announced to his people, that he is the vine and his Father is the gardener. Now, besides the fact that Jesus said it, something I really, really love about this image that he talks about, uses of him as the vine, is it's used in many, many other parts of the Bible. In fact, I'm going to show you a little section from Isaiah chapter 5, where he uses the same language, and we can see even more the reason why Jesus describes himself as the vine. You see, and throughout the Bible, the vine represents God's people in these images. And God is the gardener. And what we're going to hear is a little section from Isaiah, who wrote during a very terrible time in Israel's history. It's a time that some of us studied and in a Bible study this winter, of when God's people were not remaining in his word. They were not going to the temple, performing the sacrifices. They weren't listening to his prophets. And because of that, the fruit of the society was getting worse. Let's hear part of this song that Isaiah calls it from Isaiah chapter 5 and see this vine imagery. Isaiah wrote, "I will sing a song for the one I love, a song about his vineyard. My loved one," and this is God here, "had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He dug it up and cleared of its stones and planted it with the choicest vines. He built a watchtower in it and cut out a wine press as well. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit. Now, you dwellers in Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more could have been done for my vineyard than I have done for it? When I looked for good grapes, why did it yield only bad? Now I will tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge, and it will be destroyed. I will break down its wall, and it will be trampled. I will make it a wasteland, neither pruned nor cultivated, and briars and thorns will grow there. I will command the clouds not to rain on it. The vineyard of the Lord Almighty is the nation of Israel, and the people of Judah are the vines he delighted in. And he looked for justice, but saw bloodshed, for righteousness, but heard cries of distress." At the time Isaiah writes this, God is preparing to destroy his temple and to punish his people for disobeying him again and again, for not remaining in him. If you've had the opportunity to read through the Old Testament, or even just to read a lot of the history, you'll notice that a lot of it is a downward spiral. And at least a good part of me thinks, when I read the Old Testament, how could these people have not believed in God and been faithful to him? I mean, to see God inflict the 10 plagues on Egypt, how could they have not believed? To see God send prophet after prophet, people like Elijah and Elisha and all the famous figures we read, how could they have not seen what the truth is and believed? How could they have not marveled at his temple and taken advantage of all the customs and the law that he put in place to teach them about the Savior? But the truth is, they didn't. They did not remain in him. They did not remain in his word. But, to use this imagery, they got entangled. There are many false vines. Now, I'm not going to say all of us are like the nation of Israel, that we are at the point of apostasy, that is falling away from the faith. But something we do know is it's quite natural to not remain in God's word. There are so many other vines, there are so many other ideas out there, that when you tell people that you're a Christian, let alone that you are a Lutheran who believes in God's word and God's word only, that's a rare thing to find. And perhaps in our Canadian culture, which tends to be more individualistic and focus more on each one of ourselves, we even read these words of Jesus, and at least if you speak English, you read the you in the singular, not realizing that he's speaking to a group. Church is not just what I may be able to do with myself at home or good works that even my family can do, but it's a part of being connected to God's word, part of a family of faith. And I'll admit for myself that it can at times be hard to remain connected to God's word. How easy it is to kind of veg away and spend hours watching TV or get hyped up on things and on social media or talking to friends, that you find yourself not even able to dedicate 15 minutes a day to reading God's word. I mean, in 15 minutes a day, it's not too hard to get through the whole Bible in a year. But when Jesus says these words, that he is the true vine and his Father is the gardener, he doesn't mean this as a threat, but he means it as an invitation. Especially Jesus' disciples, who knew very well these words from Isaiah, took a lot of comfort in knowing that their Savior was the true vine. Have you considered that when Jesus calls himself the true vine, he is saying, I have borne all the fruit you need to be accepted and loved by God. We don't need to bear the fruit to be connected to God. We just need to stay connected to the branch, to Jesus. Jesus was the Israel that we never got to see in the Old Testament. Jesus was the Messiah and the King who kept God's word perfectly. Jesus was the loved one who obeyed God's will, and the one that we have celebrated the last several months, who lived, died, and then rose again. Didn't remain dead like a brown stick, but he rose. And in our gospel today, Jesus invites us. 8 times, if you counted in 8 verses, 8 times he says, remain in me, remain in me, remain in me, and you will bear much fruit. It's not what we can do on our own. It's what God enables us to do when we're connected through him, the branches. This is why, as a church, we begin all of our services in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, remembering how we are baptized and watered by the Holy Spirit. Now, to be sure, growing in Jesus' word isn't always pleasant. As he says, his Father is also the gardener, and part of that is pruning, is cutting. When we confess our sins, whether it's up here, well, I should say together as a church at the beginning of our service, or if it's admitting to a friend, close family member, how you have wronged them, that feels like cutting. It's not something that you enjoy. But it is something that is necessary. And something a bit interesting about Jesus' words here is the word that he uses for cutting or pruning, that's actually the same word for cleaning. In other words, when God prunes us, when he cuts away that sin, he cleanses us. He makes us clean before him, which is a pretty cool idea. We don't need any other vines for our growth than what God gives us himself. Again, Jesus is the vine. We remain in him. His Father, the gardener, cleanses us as we confess our sins, as we stay connected to his word. And this is why we produce fruits of faith. This is why even our small church here, Savior of the Nations, has been able to grow the way that it does. And to be sure, there are fruits of faith. Of course, we don't always know what those fruits look like. It's not just an issue of numbers, but however God makes his word grow and accomplish that purpose for which he sent it, we give thanks to him, right? And we praise him. And so today, let's take this encouragement to remain in God's word. Whether we're talking about how as a family we can structure our lives around what God teaches us, even pruning at times, when it comes to how we worship and how we do Bible studies and the events that we might carry out, our central question is always, how can we connect people to God's word so that they can grow? And as Jesus says, if we remain in him and our words remain in him, we can ask whatever we wish and it will be done for us. He says, this is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Let us remain in God's word, show ourselves to be his disciples, and God promises that he will make us bear fruit. Amen.